Harper Audio presents The Keepers, The Box and the Dragonfly by Ted Sanders, performed by Andrew Eiden. The only way of discovering the limits of the possible is to venture a little way past them into the impossible. Arthur C. Clarke. Part 1. The Find. Chapter 1. The Sign. When Horace F. Andrews spotted the Horace F. Andrews sign through the cloudy windows of the 77 eastbound bus, he blinked. Just a blink, nothing more. He was surprised to see his own name on a sign, of course, and his sizable curiosity was definitely roused. But still, he took the sighting in stride. He'd always been a firm believer in coincidences. Given enough time and enough stuff, it was only natural that the universe would churn out some odd happenings. In fact, the way Horace saw it, a universe in which strange coincidences did not occur would be a pretty suspicious place. The Horace F. Andrews sign was tall and narrow, hanging from the side of a building back in an alleyway off Wexler Street. It featured a long column of faded yellow words on a weather-worn blue background. But it was his name, written large at the bottom, that jumped out at him first, clear and unmistakable. Horace F. Andrews. The bus rolled on. Just before the sign slipped out of sight, he caught a few of the yellow words in the long list above his name. Artifacts, miseries, mysteries. Sparks of curiosity flared up inside Horace. He blinked, just once, and thought the situation through, tending those sparks like a brand new fire. What were the odds of his seeing a sign with his exact name on it? Not terrible, he decided. Horace wasn't a very common name. But Andrews definitely was, and it was probably fairly common to have F as a middle initial, certainly better than one chance in 26. Of course, it was pure chance that he was even here in the first place. The 77 was his usual bus home from school, but this was not its usual route. Normally, the bus went straight down Belmont Avenue, but construction had forced the bus to detour down Wexler Street instead of driving right by. It was also pure chance that Horace had been looking out the windows at all. Ordinarily, he would have been sitting in the very back row, reading or working on a science problem for Mr. Ludwig's class, building a bubble of concentration against the noise and confusion of the bus. But today, the bus was extra crowded, packed with rowdy kids from school in the back and stone-faced adults in the front. Horace had to stand in the middle, at the top of the steps near the rear door, feeling large and awkward, and hating his heavy backpack, and wondering just how much he, Horace Andrews, belonged here. All he could do was look out the window and hope the ride would be short. But then the sign slid by, and a block or two later, the bus slowed and jerked to a stop. The rear door opened, and a plump old lady in a purple dress began easing down the steps, clinging to the rail with both hands. Horace looked through the back windows, but the sign was out of sight. Was it for a store? Or maybe someone's office, presumably the office of Horace F. Andrews? The sign had looked very old. Maybe the place didn't even exist anymore. But then there were those words. Artifacts, mysteries. And what possible reason could any business have for putting miseries on its sign? Horace watched the old lady stretch out one chubby leg, reaching for the curb below. The other passengers rustled impatiently. A scrawny, red-faced kid Horace recognized from social studies leaned over the stairwell and started chanting at the old lady, "Go, go, go!" And then Horace stepped around the woman and jumped out of the bus. He landed heavily on the sidewalk. The old lady squawked at him and yanked her foot back. "Excuse me," Horace mumbled. He trotted away, feeling as startled as the old lady looked. He was not ordinarily impulsive, not the kind of person who simply did things without thinking them through ahead of time. But sometimes his inquisitiveness pulled him places he wouldn't ordinarily go. And that sign, those words in his name together like that. The May air was cool but held a hint of thickness that spoke of summer, of freedom and possibilities. Horace's internal clock, always accurate, told him it was 3:16. This time of day, the 77 eastbound ran every 14 minutes. He could investigate the sign and then catch the next bus, still getting home before his mother. He hurried on down the sidewalk, searching. Just as he thought he was drawing nearer to the alleyway, an enormous shape swept across his path, colliding with him hard and knocking the breath from his chest. Horace staggered back, almost tumbling into the gutter. "Goodness," said a musical voice from high above. Horace looked up, and up, into the face of the tallest man he'd ever seen. The man was so tall that he hardly looked like a man at all, 10 feet tall or more. And thin, almost as impossibly thin as he was impossibly tall, with spidery limbs and a torso that seemed too narrow to hold organs. He had hands the size of rakes, with long, skinny fingers. He stank of something chemical and foul. Horace drew back as the man leaned over him.
"Are we all right?"
the man asked, not unkindly. Again, that sing-songy voice. The man, if it even was a man, wore a black suit and dark, round sunglasses. A thick shock of black hair topped his head, out of place on his pale, skeletal body. Horace tried to catch his breath. "I'm fine," he wheezed. "Sorry."
"Perfectly understandable. I believe you were distracted."
"I'm sorry, really, just looking for something."
"Ah. Do you know what it is you're looking for?"
The man's teeth were slightly bared, as if he were trying to give a friendly grin but didn't know how. "It's nothing, really," Horace said, faint threads of alarm tingling in his bones.
"Oh, come now. Tell me what you're looking for. You can't know how intrigued I am."
"I'm just looking around. Thanks, though," Horace began backing away.
"Perhaps I can be of some assistance. You do need assistance."
He said it like a command. "No, that's okay. I'm okay." Horace skirted wide around the strange man and hustled off, trying to hunker his big frame down beneath his backpack. He was all too aware that the man's eyes were still on him. But when he looked back, he was relieved to find that the thin man was not following. In fact, he had disappeared. Completely. How could someone so large simply drop out of sight? And how could someone be so large in the first place? But it wasn't just the man who'd disappeared. The sign, too, was nowhere to be found. Horace went almost 3 full blocks without spotting it. He turned and began to methodically retrace his steps. The Horace F. Andrews sign was nowhere. Abruptly, a looming shape stepped out of the shadows in front of him. Horace stumbled to a stop. The thin man gazed down at him, still trying that gruesome smile.
"Didn't find what you're looking for?" the man sang sadly.
Panic blooming, Horace tried to catch the eyes of people passing by, hoping to draw their attention. No one even slowed. Several people sat at tables outside a deli nearby, but no one so much as glanced at the thin man. Couldn't they see him? Horace was tall for his age, and he barely came up to the man's waist. Why was no one staring? "I did, actually," Horace said at last, desperate, with no idea what he was going to say next. But then the words came to him. "That deli right there. My parents are inside, waiting for me." The man's awful grin cracked open wide.
"Of course they are," he said, gazing at the deli.
"And I wouldn't think of keeping you from them. But first, a bit of advice."
The man bent over, folding like a giant crane. He held a gaunt hand right in front of Horace's face, lifting a single long finger. The smell that came off him was burning and sour and rotten. And the man's finger was wrong. It was almost as if Did he have an extra knuckle? Horace's own terrified face curved back at him in the man's glasses.
Watch where you roam, Tinker, the man sneered. Curiosity is a walk fraught with peril.
And with that, he shot up, straightening to his full, unreasonable height. He snapped his head to the right, as if hearing some far-off sound. And then he left as swiftly as he had come, stepping out into the street. 6 great strides took him across all 4 busy lanes, and then he effortlessly hurdled the hood of a parked car onto the opposite sidewalk. He sped down Wexler, and a moment later vanished around a corner. Horace stood there for another 10 seconds, and then, his limbs coming back to life, broke into a run. Whoever, whatever this man was, Horace wanted to get far away. He made it exactly 27 steps before he was halted in his tracks again. He stood in front of an alleyway, mouth gaping open. He'd passed this alley already and seen nothing. He was sure there had been nothing to see. But now, here it was, plain as his own hands. The Horace F. Andrews sign. Or rather, not exactly. Horace stared. He forgot all about catching the bus. He even forgot about the thin man. He read the sign from top to bottom again and again. Oddments, heirlooms, fortunes, misfortunes, artifacts, arcana, curiosities, miseries, mysteries, and more at the House of Answers. Chapter 2. The House of Answers. House of Answers. That's what he had seen, not Horace F. Andrews. Similar-looking words seen from the dirty windows of a bus.
Mistaken identity, Horace said aloud,
his words echoing down the alley. The discovery disappointed him at first, but he quickly decided that the sign in reality was more intriguing than the sign he'd imagined. House of Answers was a name just begging to be investigated, wasn't it? And Horace, being Horace, definitely had questions. There were tall buildings on either side of the alley, an electronics store on the right, and a laundromat on the left that looked closed for good. The floors above both obviously held apartments. The alley itself appeared to dead end at another tall building about 50 feet back.
I don't see any answers, Horace mumbled.
He headed down the alley. It got darker and gloomier the deeper he went, and the sounds of the street faded away. He was just beginning to think he should turn around. He wasn't crazy about how narrow and high the alley was getting, when he was struck with a sense of vertigo. The back wall suddenly, dizzyingly, looked much farther away than it had. Then the alleyway seemed to open up at his feet, and Horace almost pitched down a steep flight of crumbling brick steps that he hadn't seen until he was on top of them. He caught himself, blinking. At the bottom of the staircase, barely visible in the shadows of the 3 buildings towering overhead, was an arched blue door. On the door was a round sign encircled with yellow lettering. Too small to read, but the colors were exactly the same as the House of Answers sign.
Holy jeez, Horace said. He glanced around. No one was in sight.
Slowly he eased himself down the dilapidated steps. The air grew cool. He reached the small wooden door and read the little round sign. State your name, your state. There were no other signs. No open sign, no push or pull, no hours of operation, no windows. But this had to be the place. He tugged on the rusty handle. The door held fast. State your name. Horace? He said aloud, feeling foolish. Nothing happened. Horace F. Andrews, he tried again. Still nothing. Horace looked again at the circle of words.
Wait, state your name or name your state?
But that was ridiculous. Why would anyone want him to name his state? The door was here in Chicago, and Chicago was obviously in Illinois. Illinois, he blurted out anyway, just to see. He tried the door again.
Nothing, of course.
State your name,
Horace whispered until the words started to make no sense to him whatsoever. And then he remembered the thin man's parting words.
Curiosity is a walk fraught with peril.
My state is curious. That's the state I'm in.
Horace reached out for the handle again, pulling harder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.